So my talk is on rehabilitation for fall prevention. I was expecting that first we'll go on for the assessment of fall, then I'll start with the rehabilitation. Anyway, I'll give some information on the assessment also. Then my next colleague will say all these assessment of fall prevention. If we'll see what are the learning objectives, we'll see first we'll say introduction, then definition of falls, incidence of falls, risk factors of falls, consequences, impact and outcomes of fall, management, prevention and intervention program. So first an overview, what is fall? Fall is not a disease, rather regarded as a cause leading to serious outcome, maybe it's a morbidity or mortality. So if somebody is going to fall, it may create a stage which may occur as a disease or the person may go to the dead stage also. So falls are always sudden, unexplained, but symptomatic. Falls called unintentional injury, or you can say accidental. Nobody wants to intentionally to fall. So it's unintentional injuries. The term fall-related injuries is widely used to describe the outcomes, example, brain trauma or hip fracture of fall events. There are several factors that are related to fall. For instance, a fall can occur the result of loss of footing or stroke. So many of the patients are coming to us with strokes also. As I'm working in Eastern India in a small city, Bhubaneshwar. So I'm working with a different neurologist as a point of view, speech therapy for the stroke patients. So in that meantime also, I'm associated with to check the elder population regarding this balance also. So just 1 year and 1.5 years, I started doing all these activities. Earlier, I don't have any idea that how people are managing the geriatric populations. So I'm telling, I'm using in my own way. So even if a lot of literatures are there, but still it's very difficult to analyze the geriatric population due to their cooperations. So first of all, when you'll get any patients, any geriatric population regarding fall, so first of all, we should know about the risk factor. So lot of 10 to 11 risk factors are there. If you're going to know each and every risk factor properly and also their outcomes of the risk factor, then you will plan a systematic rehabilitation or the systematic management for the fall prevention. So if you'll see the definition of fall, fall is an event which results in a person coming to rest on the ground or another lower level with or without loss of consciousness or the injury. So this is the particular definitions by the Geriatric Society. So if the person is going to fall, any consciousness level or the near the ground level, this is called fall. Where are people like to fall? Nobody is going to like to fall, but it's accidental or unintentional. So falls are the sixth leading cause of death in older adults. For people 65 years old or older, about 25% of persons aged more than 70 years, they are affected with fall. Squares et al. In 1998, they told that fall directions back. Always patient has a tendency to fall from the backside with a hip fracture. So hip fracture is the leading fall risk. And the females are more affected than males. And in the Western studies, they are telling in afternoon, all the females are going more prone for the falling. But in Indian scenario, if you'll see, many patients are coming in the morning sessions, like early morning, they are getting up from the bed and going to the toilet or the bathroom. At that time, they are having some fall, and that the hip fracture or the stroke also. If you'll see the risk factor, as I told, lot of risk factors are there. In a geriatric populations or elderly populations, if you are going to analyze all the risk factors, it's very difficult to analyze, but certain risk factors are there. 10 to 11, I'll be telling. So first is general risk factor, as history of falls, number of concurrent medications, gait impairment, muscle weakness, dizziness, vertigo, loss of consciousness, environmental and major illness. So many people are thinking, I'm talking about the dizziness. It's not like that we are talking about the dizziness and vertigo. We'll be discussing all dizziness or vertigo may be a factor. So we don't know, we are not going to deal all the vestibular management at a time to the geriatric population. We should analyze all these intrinsic and extrinsic factors. So if all the general factors, if you are going to classify into two categories, first is intrinsic, that is the personal risk factor. So first is age-related changes, that is over the 65 years. lower extremity weakness and poor grip strength, functional impairment, limited activities of daily living, poor gait and balance, low body weight, visual functions, neurological function, musculoskeletal function, lot of problems are there. Neurological functions, maybe Dr. Vishal will speak on that. Cognitive impairment or dementia, chronic illness, that is Parkinson's disease, visual difficulties, stroke, hypertension, or urinary incontinence. Psychiatric, psychoactive tranquilizers or antidepressant medications, previous any history of fall, that is very important. Heavy drinking, because previous history of falls will give you an idea that how many frequently the person is going to fall. So the intrinsic factors also, the second cause is disease, that due to medical conditions. First is sensory, second neurological, musculoskeletal, cardiovascular, gastrointestinal, metabolic and psychological. And as I said, female genders are more affected. The second are the environmental risk factors. First I explained the intrinsic or the personal factor. Now the extrinsic or the external risk factors are the polypharmacy. Means that person is using many medications from different endocrinologists, gastroenterologists or neurologists. Lot of problems they are facing. So are using four prescriptions medications, combinations such as cardiac medication, central nervous system depressants, anti-hypertensive, narcotic and chemotherapy drugs also. Environmental hazards or home hazards like loose rocks, slippery or uneven floor, poor lighting on stairs or walkways, lack of bathroom safety, example grab bars in bathtub, improper assistive device like due to fall footwear. This is very important in diabetic patients also. Now doctors are giving some different kinds of footwear to reduce their fall, and also the neuropathy conditions. Now different doctors have seen they are recommending some different kind of footwear. So here also, if the improper assistive device is there, then it is another leading cause for the fall. So as I said, two types of intrinsic and extrinsic. Some other targeted risk falls are there by Gary Ackerson and Seffert. So they have. They are telling like impairment cognitive function, impaired reaction time, depression, postural hypotension, impaired somatosensory functions, impaired postural stability, impaired vestibular system function, and impaired vision. So as I said, dizziness and vertigo, only one may cause. So that's why it's a impaired vestibular system function. But we have to analyze all the risk factors if you're going to analyze fall in elderly. So what are the consequences of fall? So first is physical consequence. Definitely one physical injury will be there. So first is skin tear and internal bleeding, subdural hematoma. Falls result in physical injuries, disability or death. Several severe injuries that require hospitalization, hypothermia, dehydration, bronchial pneumonia and pressure damage to the skin. Hip fracture is the leading cause, one of the most serious injuries, resulting annually more than 2,33,000 hip fractures according to the US studies. Immobilizations, loss of confidence due to fear of falling, disability with a reduced quality of life. If they will fall again and again, then obviously their quality of life will be affected. Psychological consequences, fear of falling can itself be debilitating. It can lead to restricted activity, decreased exercise, eventually to increased dependency, depression, anxiety, loss of confidence, social withdrawal, and institutionalization. Older adults who fall may or may not experience psychological trauma post-fall, that is fall phobia syndrome. One significant consequence of falling may be fear of falling due to aging. And the last is economical consequence, because due to hospitalization, a lot of hip fractures, they have done multiple surgeries, lot of medications, so they have a lot of economical consequences on that. So if you see, my talk is on prevention or intervention based on the rehabilitation. So first of all, we should understand, as I told, like we have analyzed all these factors, because I'm not going into details, because the next talk will speaker will speak on that assessment of fall. So by assessing all these risk factors, then you will have an idea that, okay, I'm going to give exercise, or I'm going to give some counseling, or I'm going to give some psychological counseling on this factor. So first is prevention, because prevention is always better than cure, as you know. So first is primary prevention, secondary prevention and tertiary prevention, that is multimodal intervention or prevention strategies. So primary prevention, that is personal. Secondary prevention, that is reduce fall hazards. And the tertiary prevention, that is exercise, rehabilitation and support group. That is very important, because nowadays all people are nuclear. even if their children are not with them. So they are very they are feeling loneliness. So support group is so important to make them feel good. Like, okay, in my age, all people are facing same problem also. I can do some exercise, I can maintain my stability, I can increase my muscle strength. So that's why support group is so important. So personal prevention, that is intervention for predisposing factor. First is educate patients how to use assistive devices. Because people are using it. Simple example, if we'll tell, as audiologist, we'll tell hearing aids. We are prescribing hearing aids, people are taking the hearing aids, but after taking the hearing aids to home, they don't know how to put the battery. Even if they know how to put the battery, due to some hand tremors or something like that, they are not putting the batteries properly. So they are not using it. So always they are dependent on other persons. So first of all, you should counsel them how to use the assistive device properly. Educate patients about arising slowly, count 30, change the position, do all the work slowly. Even if they are thinking we are young, but their body does not allow them to do any work. So that's why educate the patients about arising slowly. Maintain adequate hydration and provide frequent meals. Rest periods after meals. Give hypertensive medications after meal, because if they're taking any kind of medications for the blood pressure or something like that, they should continue that. Many Indian scenario I've seen, many geriatric populations, they're telling, no, earlier my BP was so high, so I was taking medication. Now I'm not taking medication without doctor consultation also. So that is a very risk factor. Educate patients about signs and symptoms of hypoglycemia and need to carry concentrated sugar. Regular eye examinations. So second, the environmental modification, what could we do? Provide adequate lighting in the rooms and hallways with switches located at room entrance. Use night keep flashlights in the bedside table in case of power failure. Arrange furniture so that pathway are not obstructed. Provide stable furniture along pathway for balance and support. Provide non-skid rugs or carpets, runners on slippery floor. Use non-skid floor wax, wipe up spills immediately. I think in all these studies or all these geriatric populations, those who are more educated and financially good, they are actually doing all these modifications or home modification, personal modifications, and environmental modifications. And lot of things available in market, but in an Indian scenario, now some things are available because due to good marketing policy and other things. But for an Indian population and for a small village guy or something, you can say poor economic condition people, they can't afford all these room modification, their toilet modification, their all these things. So, but we can advocate them, we can counsel them to use low-tech device. They can develop that low-tech device. Nowadays also some companies are there, I have seen in net, they are providing some small-tech, very cheaper devices or cheaper assistive devices to use at home. So they can use it, but we should pass on the message to them, okay, these are the problems you are facing, so use this. Because if you'll motivate the patient first, okay, these are the problem, if you have the motivation, then try to identify their problem. Because in geriatric population, they have a lot of issues, they will not tell each and everything to you. Unless until you feel familiar, if you ask a lot of questions to them, then they'll one by one, they will tell all these their psychological and related physical factors. After getting all the information, try to counsel them, relax. Once they relax, they have no depression, no anxiety for that, then counsel them to avoid all the phobic conditions. Once the phobic conditions are reduced, try to tell them, okay, you can use this low-tech device. Just modify your room, modify your conditions. As you are 65, 75 years old, lot of physical conditions are not good. You are thinking you are young, but it's not like that. So please counsel the patient, okay, use this particular device and you can reduce your fall in your home or the physical environment. Sorry. Okay, next. So what kind of assistive device we can use? Hip pads, now hip pads are available. So if, as I told, like hip fractures are more prominent in the elderly population. So one hip pad is there. If they will use that, it will reduce the hip fracture. Because hip fractures are very pathetic, they are going multiple surgeries. Even after that, with 1 year or 2 years, they can survive, but after that 1 year, 2 years, they will lose all their money and everything, and also painful situation for the family also. Then mobility aid, they can use cane, walker, wheelchairs, bathroom aids like raised toilet seats and grab bars. Use elevated toilet seat and install toilet safety frame. Apply non-skid mat on top floor. Provide handrails on both sides of bathroom. Education program to increase awareness of fall risk. Long-term care, healthy lifestyle. That is very important. Because if person is educated, person have a lot of financial condition good, they are making the lifestyle good. But due to poor family background or the socioeconomic conditions, they are not bothering about the lifestyle. They are just only after 60, 60, 75, we just want to go heaven or whatever. So even if lot of falls are there, they are depending on others, but they are not trying to do something from their end to sustain or to prevent the fall further. So as I told, if you have analyzed everything, you have counseled properly, you have done the prevention properly, then if the patient is motivated to do the rehabilitation, start the rehabilitation according to their muscle strength, according to their mental conditions, and according to their availability. That is very important. So rehabilitation, first, adequate rehabilitation physically, socially, and psychologically of injured person is very important post-fall. Aim should be reduced stiff gait, because many persons, you will see, with vestibular problem or without vestibular problem also, if they will fall once, they have a tendency to stiff their neck and they should walk like this. So if you have, this is the condition, tell them, so don't worry, relax your muscles and all this compensatory strategy you can tell them, we'll go on that. Exercise should be on to increase muscle strength, resistance training, balance and gait. So rehabilitation of fall due to vestibular problems. If vestibular problems are there, then you can go for the vestibular rehabilitation exercise in this way. First is vestibular ocular reflex adaptation exercise, because only the adaptation, habituation, substitution you can do, but if their body permits to do that substitution and habituation exercise, first is adaptation. Movement related habituation exercise, sensory system substitution exercise, improving static and dynamic postural stability, virtual reality based exercise. As you last yesterday you see saw all the practical how to do the virtual reality based exercise. Balance enhancing insoles, tai chi, one of the Chinese kung fu exercise. Balance can also we discussed on that. Dr. Surya Prakash has explained nicely on how to do the tai chi practice. So there are certified persons, they are giving training to the persons in Mumbai. People are taking certification from one guy is there. I'm not remembering his name. So tai chi is one of the good exercise. So you can do and you can train the person of, who has vestibular problem. So strengthen their muscles and to reduce the vestibular problem. Vibrotactile feedback devices, optokinetic stimulations, the Nindeto Willy balance board exercise, same as posturography platform. They have some different kind of base board just to train them different kind of strategy to improve their body strength, or you can say the ankle strategy and the hip strategy to improve their strategy that. So now many geriatric populations, they will say, okay sir, I'm maintaining my lifestyle well, I'm doing the exercise, I'm taking medications properly, I'm motivated all the, to do the exercise, but still I'm unable to stand up, then what to do? So lot of three questions they will ask. One is how to get up from a chair, how to pick an object from the floor, how to get out of bed. These three questions they will ask definitely. And you should tell them how to use the compensatory strategy. The first is place your hand on the chair's arm or at knee. Suppose they are sitting in a chair and they want to stand. So what they will do, they can hold the hand here. They can count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. They can stand. If they will stand suddenly, they will fall. Second, if there is a couch or in a table, something is there, tell them to hold the table and to stand slowly. Bend forward your trunk and lift yourself. Push on the chair's arm of knee. Then now get up, look at the front. Wait for few seconds before walking. So these steps you can at least tell them how to stand from a chair, get up from the chair. How to pick an object from the floor. Many persons, even if you, as a younger person, we have the tendency to pick up the object from the floor like this. So they have the tendency like that. But after 60, 75, they are habituated with this activity. So they will do like this and they will fall. So what we'll do, tell them to push the object near the table or wall, any support. First push, they will put through the legs or something like that. Tell to the near to the table. Then using the table as support, bend your knees and pick up the object. The best method is bend your knees and pick up the object. Lift yourself using the table for the support. Third is how to get out of bed. Many persons, they have tendency, suddenly wake up from the bed, going to the other room or going to the bathroom or toilet. That is very pathetic conditions in early morning. People are getting strokes or some kind of transient ischemic attacks, attack at this stage. So turn yourself to one side, move your leg over side of the bed, lift your trunk slowly, sit fixating in front of you, wait, move your head and neck in all the planes. When you woke up, then try to move your planes, see all the objects are in proper position, you are feeling good, then go to out of the bed. And then you can stand up. So these are some compensatory strategy. You can teach them. Many people, they know it, but they are not using it. So, but as you are dealing with those patients or populations, write it in a chart or any kind of leaflet of content, give it to them, or you can instruct them. Now, if the patient have confidence, lot of confidence, they are doing adaptation exercise very well, then habituation exercise so nicely, then you can go for the clinician direct based program for the substitution. As I explained in, I told all these things in morning. So first is balance beam. Okay, so tell the patient to properly make the balance, any kind of properly sit, stand on balance. Then balance board exercise, giving nowadays different kind of balance board are coming. Physiotherapists are more aware about such balancing board. So try to them to stand on that, hold them properly, make them confidence, try to make your good knee strategy or ankle strategy properly, make a good strength and stand. All these condition, eyes open condition, don't try in eye closed condition. Trampoline work with eye closed, ball kicking, very difficult to them to kick a ball, but they can just do one leg ball kicking. Then ball toss, crossover steps, different crossover steps they can do here, or they can go for there here, different crossover. Stepping patterns, you can change the stepping patterns from this side to that side, or some obstacles you can keep and tell them to change the directions. Side stepping, tell them to go for the side stepping. What I am doing very regularly, telling them to bend the knee like this, do like this, continuous for 10 times. Then keep it like this, again, 10 times like this, keep it like this, bend the knee, do it from front side, do it from back side. So all the muscle strength you can do in this a simple way. Then foam work, it's a 8 thickening of foam pad you can take. First tell them to work on that, or work on 2 to 2, then walk heel to toe, then walk diagonal, walk backward. When the person will do backward, that means he will improve a lot, but very difficult to do in a genetic population. Walking with eye closed, very last, but very difficult. So if I'm doing regularly exercise, but how could I say that the person is improving? So these are the assessment, that is subjective assessment. I don't know my next speaker will speak on this or not. First, we'll do on subjective assessment, that is dizziness handicap inventory, to check their physical, emotional, and functional handicapness, activities specific balance, confidence, the vestibular activities of daily living scale, sought for medical outcomes, hospital anxiety and depression scale, geriatric depression scale. You can analyze any of this. I'm using only dizziness handicap inventory and geriatric depression scale to check their level. And after doing a lot of exercise, lot of training, lot of counseling sessions, their handicapness are reducing and they are improving. So from the conclusion, I can say like falls and related injuries, example fractures, are significant health hazards to the aging society. identifying fall risk factors, as I said, all the 10 to 11 fall risk factors are so important to evaluate problems and to plan personal and community intervention strategy. So if you have analyzed properly, and also you can analyze musculoskeletal, neuromuscular, or neurological, all these things systematic way, lot of instrumental and nowadays available lot of you can say format models like Borg balance test, Tinetti fall test, lot of models are available. You can print out, take a printout from the net, do it at tell the patient to fill up it, or you can ask lot of questions to them. One by one, you can evaluate their balance in a different strategy or different level. Okay, so these are the intervention or prevention strategy for the fall prevention in elderly population. Thank you so much.